Good evening, everyone. My name is Nico, and welcome to the 2020 Carmel High School Film Festival. Every year, the Video 1 and Video 2 classes submit their films to be presented to a panel of judges and then shown for all of you here tonight.
Hello, Carmel High Video students. My name is Greg Mettler, and I'm an instructor at MPC in Cabrillo. I teach video and photography. I'm coming to you from my studio in Sand City, where I have a dark room and a shooting space. I was one of your judges for your video projects for Mr. Granberry's class, and I enjoyed watching all of them. Some of them were super funny. A lot of them had really good editing and content in them. And so good job, everyone. Continue making art, right now especially. It's really important to make video and other types of art during this time of COVID. It really draws people together. My wife is a teacher at Carmel High School, Mrs. Mettler, and our whole family watches the Friday videos. And it helps us feel like we're part of a community even though we're isolated in our homes. So keep at it. On a professional note, learning to edit video and create good content is going to be important no matter what job you get, whether that's in the creative fields or anything else. All companies need people that can do or have those skills. So good job, everyone. Enjoy your summer. Bye.
Hi, I'm Connor. Tonight's awards will be handed out for best editing, best cinematography, best story, and several others. Cash prizes will be sent out to the winning students.
To say this year was an unusual year is an understatement. Students generally have access to cameras, microphones, tripods, computers, and many other pieces of filming equipment, as well as locations, actors, and crew members.
Yeah, but not this year. We were sent home right as we were planning our capstones, and we had to film using our phones and edit using our home computers or just whatever we could get our hands on. But as they say in this industry, the show must go on. And I gotta say, the results were astounding.
Each of these videos tonight have been judged by industry professionals. The judges are Matt Pendergast, Aaron Clark, and Greg Mettler. We would like to thank these judges for participating in this festival.
We would also like to thank Padre Parents for all their generosity in donating all the prize money in the show tonight. And without further ado, let's get this show started.
Awards, because I sure do. The first award will be given for writing and storytelling. Every great movie has a beginning, middle, and end that engages their viewers with compelling stories, characters, and drama. Here are the finalists and winner for best writing and story.
This getting in the wrong hands. Is this yours?
Why can't I talk?
Okay, I'll take that as a yes.
Wallet? Whose stuff is this? Apple Money 27604? Maybe an address? What happened? What am I even doing outside barefoot? And why can't I remember anything? Okay. 27604. 27604. Wait, is this it? Whose house is this? I guess I'll knock. Maybe someone can help me. It's open. Wait, is this my house? This picture kind of looks like me. Maybe there's someone in the backyard. Is that a river? Head. That's weird. Crystal? So I found a crystal in the river, but where did it go? The note. Return the crystal and no one gets hurt. Who else knew about it? Is this my room? Oh my gosh, my head. So, somebody was trying to take the crystal from me, but who? Who was I running from? It was her.
Hello. OMG, hey, Sydney. I just thought that I would call you and see what you were up to. I just ran 8 miles since I'm training for another race this week. You know, Sydney, we are getting older and you still haven't found out what you're good at yet. Everybody seems to have their own thing except you.
So you think I'm talentless?
Thank you.
The next two awards go to cinematography and editing. Cinematography is the art of visual storytelling. Cinematography includes camera work, composition, lighting, and the way the film looks. Editing entails taking a film and video that was shot under the camera and putting it all together with music, sounds, pacing, rhythm, and flow to create a cohesive story. Here are the finalists and awards for the best cinematography and the best editing.
Thank you. stay? I don't know, Mom. Probably in her room. Okay, I'll go check.
Anika's not in her room.
But didn't you check for her earlier?
Yeah, I went upstairs, but the door was locked, so I figured she was just getting ready for bed or something. But I came back upstairs and it was still locked.
Well, maybe she just fell asleep.
No! I got so worried when she wouldn't open the door that I used a bobby pin to get in and her bed wasn't touched. So I checked the bathroom and she wasn't in there either.
Mom, did you hear that?
Neil, what are you talking about?
There it is again!
Okay, tell me what's up right now. This isn't a joke. I'm serious.
Okay, well, a couple hours ago, we were just playing basketball after dinner like usual for like a whole hour. And then all of a sudden, the ball landed right next to this dumb rock and Anika was all intrigued by it. So I told her she was being dumb and she got all mad at me. So I went back to playing basketball and then she put it in her pocket. She said she had to pee and ran upstairs.
And then?
I don't know. She never came back. Just thought she was mad, so I didn't go check on her.
Well?
Mistake?
Huh?
What's going on?
You want to play basketball after we're done?
Duh.
Wait for me.
Well, that's not my problem. I finished first, so I'm allowed to warm up.
Loser.
Whatever, I'll be out in a second.
Neil, what are you doing? Neil, turn around. Neil, throw that away right now.
What?
I'm not joking.
What are you even talking about?
Neil, please throw that over the fence right now. I'm serious.
Anika, shut up.
Neil! I can't explain it. You just have to trust me. Put the rock down.
Freak. Look, there's a message under all the dust.
Stop it! Stop!
Neil, stop! I'm serious.
I can barely understand you.
Mom, Neil's gone!
What are you talking about? Neil's over there.
Huh?
I made your favorite, pasta.
Yes, you haven't made pasta in forever.
Well, your dad was in the mood for Italian, so... Why not? There's soda in the fridge. Do you want me to make garlic bread with your food? Okay.
I recorded the Avengers for us to all watch tonight.
No, of course not. Are you crazy?
Thank you.
Carmel Unified School District lies on the Monterey Peninsula in the central coast of California. Carmel is long famous for its quaint town, nice beaches, and beautiful scenery. But what is often overlooked is the quality of education available in the school district. On October 29th, 2019, the Carmel High School video class took a trip to every school in the district. In this film, we will uncover the themes that connect this expansive school district together. The following interviews were collected from Carmelo School Child Development Center, Carmel River School, Tularcidos Elementary School, Captain Cooper School, Carmel Middle School, Carmel Valley High School, and finally, Carmel High School. Our main objective was to capture what one day at CUSD would be like. We interviewed several teachers and students about their experience and what makes their school special.
At Carmelo, we follow two curriculums, and all the classes follow the same one. It's Tools of the Mind and the Pyramid curriculum, and we really work on social-emotional development with the children, friendship skills, self-regulation, all things that they're going to need in the future that's going to serve them well.
Hopefully they expect a variety of experiences and to be engaged in what they're learning about. We're fortunate in that we have a lot of specialists here as well as the classroom teacher. So they participate in science and PE and Spanish. And in the classroom, we do a lot of collaborative group work. So hopefully they're engaged in what they're learning.
You leave here with a certain knowledge, of course, with academics, but I think more importantly, social skills and how to deal with people. How to be a good listener, how to be a good partner.
I think that they prepare the kids really well. It's not only because we're focused on the academic foundation, but we really are in an era where we want them applying those skills to the real world too.
We try to prepare them here in fifth grade to get ready for, I always say it's like the last of the honeymoon period here at elementary school, because it's the big leagues starting next year and in high school as well.
Well, personally, I think the most important part of middle school is not the academics, but learning the social skills you need to get through life. Middle school is really tough, right? The three hardest years I think that kids go through as they're developing and trying to figure out friendships and figuring out how different people work and groups and peer pressure for the first time and all those types of things. And so I think we do a really good job here of making sure that students receive the skills that they need to go up against the challenges that they're gonna have. So I think social and emotionally we do a really good job. They've got great clubs and different activities that they can participate in during lunch and after school. So they always kind of have a place to land.
We definitely work and collaborate as a team here at the middle school to provide the best curriculum possible. I also love that we do the vertical articulation with the high school, so we understand the needs of where they need the students to be, so we can provide that for our eighth graders to make sure they're prepared for high school. High school definitely has a rigor that we want to make sure that our students know what they're in store for.
Very early into our journey around the school district, it became clear that there were shared themes that kept coming into the conversations we had with teachers and students. Despite promoting high academic prowess, the curriculum throughout the district, especially in the early years, also focuses on teaching valuable social skills. Another theme that prevailed throughout the district was its environmental awareness. Almost every school campus had an element of environmentalism, whether it be a garden, an ocean guardian banner, or an entire habitat. It's only natural that a school located in such a beautiful location would gravitate toward caring about nature.
This is our garden. It is really cool, especially that we have a lot of fruits.
The students are brought up in a way to care about the earth, I've noticed. The previous school that I worked at, the environment wasn't a heavy push among the students, but here, whenever I brought up things about the environment, they would look up at me and say, yeah, they've heard of that before, they've thought of that before. That's one thing that I think is special.
Maybe there's girls over there.
Captain Cooper School is a very unique and special place.
We have a very small community of students, only about 55 students at our school. And we have some really amazing teachers. We only have 5 full-time teachers, and they're all fantastic doing the work that they do. We also have a STEAM program and a garden program that is really unique to our site also.
We're an ocean guardian school, so making sure that we're protecting the oceans that surround us and just constantly getting the message out to students that we need to really care about this area, especially because of how beautiful it is, and we want to leave it kind of how we've come to it.
The kids also, you know, have this amazing habitat out here that they get to come out for their humanities classes, their language classes, and their science classes. So this is also an amazing experience for the nature studies classes.
Many interviews also discuss the freedom that the schools provide to foster growth in people's interest. This progression of freedom is exemplified in the later stages of school with the wide variety of elective choices, as well as Carmel Valley High's unique approach to practical, intern-based education.
So what makes us different is we go to school Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Every student's here. We do English. We do all the subjects that everybody else does. We do lots of projects. But on Tuesdays and Thursdays, students don't actually report here. They actually go to an internship. And I know you probably will see a couple internships on this film. We have a couple of students placed at Carmelo. And we have a couple of students placed at Captain Cooper School. You know, we have basically lots of different internships, and that's what we hope to achieve for all students.
Since I've been an intern here, it's really cool. And like, I like the teachers a lot, and spending time with these kids is really cool and really sweet. It's fun.
I went to CHS to do an internship with Mr. Brewer. He does wood workshop and mechanics. It will help me start a auto body shop so I can be a mechanic.
I really love that we can be free and that we can like go out during lunches and do a lot of stuff. We can play basketball. We can go watch movies with other classes. And my favorite class is probably math, because I'm really good at it.
My favorite part is the kids and teachers.
My favorite part about middle school is how we have multiple classes and multiple teachers.
There's this sense of trust that we're always looking out for the best of the kids. Overall, the middle school teachers love having fun with the kids, and I think the kids have a fun time in their classes.
If there was one way to encapsulate what Carmel Unified School District is, it would be community. At the core of all the themes we've explored is the interconnectivity of students, teachers, and families.
I get to really know my students and their families. So I'd say the big thing is just knowing them as people and knowing their parents, building that kind of relationship. I just the kind of conversation that we have, it's beyond kind of surface level.
We have a lot of activities that bring the community together, and we have a great sense of community here with our families.
We have a really great school community, and we all care for each other. The kids are very kind, and the whole community, the whole village comes together for these kids.
I think the staff here just loves kids. They love to teach. They love to see students learn. I think the kids come to school with a mentality that they're excited to come to school.
You just feel when you come onto campus that you're part of something, that you're not by yourself, that you're not alone on an island, compared to a lot of other schools where it's, you know, kids are doing school. I think here students are passionate about the things that they're passionate about. I think the teachers are passionate. And I think that comes through the second you step onto campus, you feel that. Certainly as somebody who's new to this part of the world, I've not for a second felt out of place or, you know, felt like I wasn't welcomed. You know, I became a padre pretty quickly.
Beneath the surface, Carmel Unified School District is not simply a panorama of beautiful valleys, hills, and ocean views. It is a tightly knit community, a single family connected by one unified love of learning valuable skills, protecting the environment that we share, and helping every individual find their path to success. That is what makes CUSD special. two major genres of films are documentary and narrative. Narrative films are fictional accounts of characters and their journeys. Documentary films are non-fictional accounts of real life and an attempt to inform the viewers on a particular topic. Documentary or informative films rely on interviews, B-roll, and pulling compelling stories out of the world around us. We find the story. Here are the finalists and winners for Best Informative and Narrative Videos.
Hi, my name is Ruby Carr. I am a sophomore at Carmel High School and about to be a junior. I am 16 years old and slowly starting to grasp who I am and who I want to be. I have many interests and hobbies that bring me joy and take me on a little escape from reality. Personally, I have struggled with depression and anxiety and just maintaining my happiness. In the past, I often felt alone and on my own in the world, but with the help of new friends, reaching out, and letting go, I have been able to find myself moving on and in a better place. This brings me to my capstone idea for video production. I just wanted to make a little video to remind everyone that you are not alone in your struggles, and there are many around you going through similar circumstances. Sometimes, knowing there are people standing beside you and supporting you can mean the world. At least, I know it does for me. So as you watch the next few clips, it would mean the world to me if you remember them when you are feeling lost. Remember them when you feel small. Remember that we are all here with you and taking this crazy thing called life head on, together. To prove to you that others are feeling the same emotions and that we're all much more connected than you may have thought, I asked a few of my classmates some specific questions. To start off, I asked how they're feeling in that moment.
At this very moment in my life, I feel really good. I know a lot of people have been stressed with the current pandemic, but for me, it's a way I can really take time to myself.
I'm doing pretty good. I'm feeling pretty happy. I'm feeling more energized than I've been in years.
How are you in this general moment?
I am doing really good. Yeah, I'm doing really good. I'm happy.
Next, I asked what they thought was the hardest thing about being a teenager.
I think the hardest thing about being a teenager, especially nowadays, is having to deal with technology and social media.
It's probably like getting through all the years of school and living up to like expectations and just making sure your future's good.
I feel like there's a lot of pressure. You have to do well, you have to get good grades, you have to go to a good school. That's what I think is like being a teenager. A lot of pressure, I guess.
I also asked what they thought was the hardest thing about opening up.
The hardest thing about opening up for me is the fear that my personal stories will be leaked to the whole community, and that's just not fun.
You can't erase from their memory. And they know that about you, and they can do what they want with that information.
Probably have to be being judged by other people, because I think the worst feeling is opening up and then someone judging you for what you opened up for.
Next, I asked what advice they have for someone struggling with anxiety.
Every moment is just a moment, and then in the grand scheme of things, everything will even out and everything will turn out perfectly fine. And it may seem difficult in the moment, but it's just a moment.
I think seeing a therapist or talking to friends or a staff member or family member is huge, and trust me, it will make you feel so much better.
Be present always and realize that there's always a better way. Personally, I never realized that, and I would always think about what could happen rather than what is actually happening.
Another question I asked was, what was some things that they were struggling with?
I definitely struggle with self-love the most.
Time management right now is the biggest thing.
Wanting to be successful, that I work myself too hard sometimes.
Next, I asked what advice they have for someone struggling with depression.
focus on what makes you happy instead of what would make other people happy or what other people want you to do, because your life is going to be so much more enjoyable.
Let go of all those negative thoughts and surround yourself with people who are positive and will help you through those times.
There's light at the end of the tunnel, and that whatever you're struggling with right now won't be with you forever, and just to try to find the positive in every situation, no matter how bad it seems.
Overall, being a teenager comes with many struggles, especially when you feel you're going through your days alone. So this was just a little reminder for everyone listening. Teenager or not, you are not alone.
There's 7 billion other people in the world. There's going to be at least one more person that cares about you.
You're not alone. One thing to remember is that you're not, because guess what? There are 7 billion people on Earth, and I guarantee someone is feeling the exact same way.
All emotions are impermanent, so it is likely that it will ease with time.
We are all here, maybe not going through all the same things, but that is why we have each other, to lean on and get that support we need. Thank you for watching, and I hope you're able to take away from this. And always remember, you are not alone.
In early 2020, the world was shaken by a global pandemic, a virus called COVID-19. Cities shut down, people had to self-isolate, and schools transitioned from in-class learning to online learning. COVID, or coronavirus, supposedly originated in Wuhan, China, where it rapidly spread to Italy, Europe, and then America. This caused massive nationwide shutdowns. Movie theaters closed, shops had to shut their doors, even the Walt Disney theme parks had to close. One of the hardest hit parts of our way of life were schools, where schools had to close and transition into online learning, where teachers have to teach their classes and assign homework through the internet. While some of us students mostly think about how we are going to deal with this online learning, we tend to forget that this is all new for teachers too. Because of this, I asked a couple of teachers how they were transitioning to this new uncertain time.
Yes, I do find it incredibly hard to stay focused. Working, I keep working. It's kind of part of my routine at this point. Working from home for me is a lot like weekends have always been. I always do my grading in the morning on the weekends. So getting up and coming straight downstairs and hopping on the sofa with my laptop and grading papers for 3, 4, 5 hours is pretty much the life of an English teacher. So now that we're doing almost everything online, I just follow the same routine 5 or 6 days a week.
It's definitely taken a while to get used to this distance learning. And it's definitely been a bit difficult to focus, especially again when the sun is out and I just want to be outside. And just trying to learn all these new apps and ways of teaching digitally has been kind of, confusing, I guess, and just time consuming, but I'm getting there. I'm more of a fan of interaction and, you know, class discussions and things. So this has been definitely a challenge, but I'm getting there.
I'm definitely, as far as staying motivated, definitely not a work at home type of person. The first couple weeks was definitely hard to like find a schedule and a routine. And like find a purpose to like get up in the morning. And so it was definitely hard trying to find that routine of like when you need to work and getting things done. So after the first couple weeks though, like eventually got like a schedule set up and stuck with that.
So I've been doing all right distance teaching, but the hardest part for me is getting stuff done at home because I have 2 boys who were doing homeschooling, so they're requiring a lot of attention, so I have to be very diligent in when I do my teaching stuff. So it is a little bit harder to stay focused because that we're trying to make sure that they always have stuff to do.
Now, one important thing that is on every student's mind is grading. And so, I asked teachers about how they're approaching grading in distance learning.
I'd say my grading itself has remained the same. Like I haven't changed rubrics for what an A is or what a B is or C is. So those grade requirements haven't changed. I think what's changed has been my flexibility regarding students turning in late work or taking an extra day or two, or understanding that when a student kind of goes missing in action for 2 or 3 days or longer, once I'm able to communicate with them and kind of get them back in the fold of the class, I'm certainly open to them doing work late for full credit still.
I found that I've been giving kids a lot more leeway. I'm trying to just make sure that they're staying engaged and just giving them credit. I'm definitely not grading harder. As long as they're getting stuff in, I'm giving them credit.
Now, while grading is important, actual teaching in their curriculum are important as well. For some teachers, they have not had to change their curriculum much, while other teachers have had to make drastic changes.
I don't know. I feel like there are certain subjects that lend themselves more to distance learning than others. I think English is fairly easy unless you don't have the novels you need to teach, but I haven't really adjusted a whole lot. You know, like I said, most of my assignments are writing based, and I've been able to kind of preserve those. The only thing I've really adjusted is I've kind of cut a few things out.
Pretty much I've just thrown out everything and started fresh. So like instead of giving the unit 5 test and then assigning unit 6 novels to read, and I've just kind of had to revamp everything. So Mrs. Owens and I have been meeting together a lot, you know, with these Zoom calls, and we've just created like a whole new curriculum.
The last thing I want to discuss is how we, the students, can help our teachers, as they have lives and families too.
To make my life easier, it would be great if, you know, students just turn their work in on time, because we're using turnitin.com. And so if a student turns in an assignment late, I will have no idea because Turnitin doesn't send me any sort of notifications. So I won't even know to go back and to grade it unless a student emails me and says, hey, I turned this in, and then I can do that. So, I mean, ideally, it would be easiest for me if everybody just did everything and turned it in on time, but I understand that that's not necessarily going to happen, and that's totally okay.
You know, I think flexibility is important for teachers right now, but I also think it's important for students to realize that we have our own schedules to adhere to as teachers. We don't really want to work at 8 p.m., 9 p.m., 10 p.m. So getting emails and text messages at late hours is a little inconvenient, and kind of keeping things in school hours, I think, would be helpful. The other thing I'd say is, although definitely, like, I understand that these are extenuating circumstances, students turning in work on time, students doing their best, students finding motivation within themselves all makes a big difference. When late work trickles in, it does create a lot of work at the end for teachers or past when they think they're kind of done grading something.
You know, the best thing for students to do is to reach out if they need help or to engage with the teacher. In my experience, I do a lot of emails out, or I do a lot of trying to reach out, and I don't get much info back. So just responding or dropping your teacher a note or letting them know that you finished an assignment, I think just communication, because that's the hardest thing, is we're not in touch. We don't see each other every day. So finding a way to stay in touch is helpful. So when I send out like the weekly email, hey, just the response, like, hey, I got your email, thank you very much, like, I'll make sure I get my stuff in, or how are you doing, just kind of a check-in, I think that would be that'd be helpful, and let me know if I need to make adjustments or if I need to maybe someone's struggling and I need to reach out, but I don't know that if no one communicates. So that would be helpful, is just, you know, letting me know how things are going and checking in, you know, kind of like a two-way street.
In these troubled and uncertain times, it would do us students well to remember that while we are going through hardships, our teachers are as well, and we could do our very best to help them out.
I'm 26 years old, oldest of 8 siblings, 7 girls, 1 boy. I mean, it's hard being the oldest. I mean, I gotta set an example. You know, it's a lot of pressure knowing that you were put on this earth to guide the way for the next generation, you know? It's a lot of weight on my shoulders. You know, I especially feel bad for my brother Grover. never really knew his father. Pops passed away 18 years ago, peacefully in a Zamboni accident. It's game 4 of the Stanley Cup Finals, Sharks up 3 games.
How could a Zamboni accident be peaceful?
Guy doing what he loved, okay? Philly cheesesteak was thrown into the ice. Extra sardines, lightly toasted. Pretty much Dad's signature sando. He had no chance. At this point, I'm just trying to be the father figure for Grover that he never had. And I'm happy to be that for him. Grover, get inside! It's not safe!
Would you say you've used Spike as a father figure?
Spike? No, far from it. You know, he's a high school dropout. I don't know that he has any... I don't know what that guy does.
Introducing Shirtless Hood. The wearable, fashionable hood with no shirt. Shirtless hood.
This guy's an idiot.
I'd say the number one rule that I live by, besides being the beast every day, the machine that you was born to be, would probably be to get out and breathe some of that fresh American air that you are so blessed to be able to breathe. Usually go for a drive or two during the day.
Where does he go on those daily sacred drives? Who the hell knows? But all I know is he's been putting diesel in that car for 3 weeks now. I don't know how it runs.
Whoa. Hey, sorry guys, but my daily drive is sacred. It's the end of the road for you guys.
So are you sure you don't know where he goes?
Well, I really shouldn't be driving. I only have my permit.
It's okay. He does this every day?
Pretty much, yeah.
You've never followed him?
Oh, this will be the first time.
Where do you think he goes?
Oh, stop right here.
Dad, I miss you. Lots been going on. Grover and I, we're bonding. I don't know, we've spent a lot of time together.
Wish you were here, Dad.
I just forgot I brought you your favorite. Philly cheese, extra sardines, lightly toasted.
How you doing, Spikey? This is your dad. Thanks for the Sandy. I know times have been real tough for you and Grover, but I've come to you with a message from the heavens. Shirtless Hood is your destiny. Your future and fortune await you if you shall choose to act on your dream.
I don't know, Dad. It hasn't really worked that well for me in the past. I don't know if it'd be a hit.
Look, I want to give you a little piece of advice. I wish I would have given you when I was still alive. Always follow your dreams, Spikey. I love you, son, and I am very proud of what you are soon to become. Shirtless Hood. Shirtless Hood!
And I was like, yo.
I'm Spikey Toledo with Shirtless Hood Trademark, and we're here once again to ask for your financial support. What's the number one problem with going shirtless? Not having a hood. Well, now you don't have to with Shirtless Hood.
Hood! Yo.
Play basketball at the middle school?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I'll be there in about 15 minutes.
Well, I'm gonna finish my breakfast first.
Whatever, man. Just hurry up.
Cool. See you then. Hey man, I think I'm gonna be a little late.
What? Why?
There's like an invisible wall in front of my driveway.
That doesn't even make sense.
I don't know, man. I'm gonna try and figure this out. Thank you.
Hello?
Hey, man.
You break that wall yet?
Nah, man. I stopped trying like a while ago.
So you're just giving up?
I wouldn't say that, but right now I'm kind of just focusing on myself. Yeah, I've been eating healthier, doing puzzles, reading books and whatnot.
Wow, look at you go.
Yeah, by the time this is all said and done, I feel like I'm gonna leave this place better than when I came in.
Just don't stay in that house forever.
Yeah, man, I won't. I'll talk to you soon. Alright, later.
Thank you.
As stated previously, under normal circumstances, filmmaking is a difficult task. Under our current situation, it is even more difficult. Some students rose to the occasion and created compelling stories in their limited worlds around them. So this year, we have a new award, the Most Impressive Accomplishment During a Quarantine. Here are the finalists and the winner.
Elle Bowman here, reporting live with the documentary of a little girl that is known as The Boss. I got to interview and talk with her family on how they feel about the situation and what they do for her on an everyday basis.
My purpose is to read Bryn all the books that she could love and do whatever I can to help her be a smarter little person.
She's bossy because I think she's the third child. She really wants to be heard and be a part of everything. She's got a really strong personality, so she's just bossy.
What makes Bryn the boss pretty much is she always bosses everybody around, so we decided that she's gonna be the boss from now on.
I don't wish I was the boss of the family because I feel like Bryn plays a role very well and I don't think I could top that. She just knows what she wants, and I don't think I could replace her.
What I do for Bryn is cook her breakfast, pack her lunches, clean her room, help her with her horse, pretty much everything.
What makes me the ultimate boss is controlling people, holding people. That's it, yeah.
Many things make Bryn the boss. The main thing is she knows she's the boss, so she knows she can boss anyone around to do anything that she wants.
Bryn's usually very nice to me, but she can be short at times and a little bit pushy. She usually likes to tell me what she wants, tells me what she wants to eat, and tells me to get it for her.
I like my mom to do, turn on the TV for me. I make my dad brush my teeth and do my hair.
She is annoying, because she, when I'm building a Lego, she like talks to me always. And then when she's talking to me, I mess up.
Bryn has made me cry many times. She's a very loud yeller. She is very mean to me, and especially being the oldest, it's hard for me to accept that the littlest one has all my power and takes full advantage of whatever I can do for her.
I control people by my brain because I ask them to do it.
We tell her that she needs to go to her room at times, and we take things away that she loves, like tell her that she can't ride her pony if she's too bossy and not polite. And that usually works.
I ask people to do my clean my room. I ask people to play with my toys. I ask people to put stuff on me. I ask people to turn on my lights.
I'm scared of her because she's always like chasing me. I have to hide always, so it's weird.
What she does to be really bossy is she's just really loud. It's not that she's really bossy, she's just very in the middle of everything and loud.
Bryn completes our family because without her, we wouldn't have that core holding us together, making sure we get things done every day and doing it right.
I think she completes our family because we need a boss and she's our baby boss, so.
Yes, she completes our family because even though she's challenging at times and loud, it'd be weird not to have her.
Well, yeah, I'd say Bryn definitely completes our family because with the three children, there's a little bit of everything. And Brynn gives us everything we can handle and maybe sometimes a little more.
There you have it, folks, a touching documentary of a family and how they found their core, even if it means it's the boss and youngest of the family, they would not be who they are without her. And don't forget,
I'm the boss.
I've called you two soldiers here for one reason. What would that be, sir? I need you two to go to Jabba's palace. The Halo guys have taken over that base. They're hiding some plans there for their master base. I need you to steal them. Now go. Right away, sir. You there. Yes, you. Yes, Commander? Get a shuttle ready for launch. Whoa, are those Star Wars guys? Commander, Star Wars guys are here. Humphrey, I'm beginning to get the feeling that Vader sent us here as a joke. No one's even here. Look around. Nah, I don't think he'd do that to us. I'm probably just paranoid. Surrender now, or you and all the Star Wars guys will be crushed. So, should we surrender? Nah, let's just call for reinforcements. Good thinking.
Excuse me, Commander.
Yes, what is it?
There's a transmission coming through from Captain DeMarcus and Humphrey, sir.
Good. Put it through to Lord Vader immediately.
And then I said, what's with the long face? Oh, good times, good times.
Vader, thank God you answered. We're covering heavy fire down here. We need reinforcements now. It will be done. Admiral.
Yes, sir?
Prepare a gunship with the finest troops.
I'm on it, sir.
Where are those reinforcements at? I'm sure they'll be here soon.
Where's that coming from?
Finally, about time you showed up.
We've got to go get those plans for the base. Let's go through that door. Hey look, they're right over there.
I see you've fallen into my trap. These are the plans you're looking for? Too bad you will not get them.
Oh yeah? Well, DeMarcus and I think otherwise.
You fools! Now you will meet the same fate as your friend. Not if I have anything to do with it. This is the end for you, Vader.
You go back and fight the battle. I'll stay here with him.
Yes, sir.
Well, that's the end of him. Better go back now. Yo, guys, I just killed the Arbiter.
Did you remember to grab the plans?
I'll be right back.
Oh, Vader. Vader. You're not getting away with those plans, Vader. I will destroy you.
Oh, not this guy again.
Well, who's that?
That's Dooku. He used to work for us, but now he works for the Halo guys. God, that's so lame. This is the end for you, Vader. I will destroy you.
Yeah, I'm not listening to that guy anymore.
Dooku and the Arbiter are dead? We won the war! We won! I'm Han Solo, I'm Han Solo, I'm Han Solo, I'm Han Solo.
tonight. Finally feeling free and it feels so right. Oh,
we ready? Here we go. A one, a two, a one, two, three, and make me an angel who flies from Montgomery. Make me a poster of an old rodeo. Yeah.
Great, but I think we need to find a new place to gig or something because we haven't been invited back.
What? We killed it! I swear those places loved us. Every seat was filled. I don't understand how they wouldn't want us back.
They were basically empty.
I agree, honey. We did do a great job at our last three gigs, but I think we need to find a more steady venue or we're gonna lose respect as artists.
Artists? We've had three gigs, and none of the places have invited us back, and all he does is stand there and shake the tambourine.
Oh, and he does a darn good job of it too, honey.
Thank you, honey.
I love my kids, don't get me wrong, but Carver's heart, it's not in it. And our music, oh, it's so on point. We're a tight-knit group, you know? And my husband, oh, he really pulls the whole thing together.
Some better material.
Better material? I'm writing all of our songs and they're amazing.
Amazing? Face it, they're garbage.
Well, then why don't you write our songs for us then?
I don't want to.
Why?
Because I don't want to be a part of this stupid band in the first place. This rehearsal is over. Judge if you want, but I said what I said and I stand by it. My mom promised me $100 for four gigs, but I just can't stand it. My sister is so annoying.
Sometimes I could kill him.
I love it when they play fight. I wish they'd stay this age forever.
God, why is he like that?
Oh, honey, give him some time. He'll come around. In the meantime, I think I'm gonna go to CVS if you care to join me.
I'm okay. I think I'll sit this one out.
All right, suit yourself. See you guys later.
You know, I saw a documentary about the Beatles, and you know, they went through some stuff too.
I just forgot my phone. Don't think I'm here to apologize or anything. Where did Mom go?
The CVS.
Huh.
Wait. Carver, I know you love this band. I do too. And that's why I think we need to talk.
About what?
So who's it gonna be?
I think you know.
Don't ask me. I have no clue what they're talking about.
There comes a time for every great band when they need to come together and make the difficult decision of who no longer belongs in that band. Now, luckily for us, we're not being invited back to gigs, and I think we all know why.
Wait, you're kicking me out of the band?
What? Of course not. We would die up there without you.
Oh, I know then.
So who's gonna tell her?
You are.
Me? Why me? You should do it.
No, you're the one she's paying to be in the band.
Exactly, then it's like I'm telling her just like, give me your money and scram.
Perfect, you know what to say then.
No, I just, that's...
It's settled. You want her out of the band, you tell her. I know you can pretend that you hate this band, but I know you want to be a rock star all your life, you have, but it will never happen with your mommy holding you back.
Fine.
I love my wife. She just doesn't have the skills to cut it.
Wow, great job, guys. That sounds really great.
Yeah, we actually wanted to talk to you about something.
You're out of the band!
What? Me? Why?
I'm sorry, but we're playing at a level up here, and you're playing at a level way down here.
What? Well, fine, I'm just... That's
Laura,
fine.
Wait.
No, I thought of all people, you would have my back. Fine, I'm gonna start my own band. See how you like it. Goodbye. They'll see. They'll see that they need me. And then they'll come crawling back.
It had to be done. Like ripping off a band-aid.
Well, we should probably get some practicing in.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 3, 2, 1. We all live here. Can we at least talk?
About what? About how you guys kicked me out of the family band that I started?
It had to be done. We weren't keeping gigs and you didn't make the cut.
You know what? I'm out of here.
Well, you know, it should be nice if you guys could help. I can't do everything by myself.
Fine.
You guys should see this.
Oh, what?
Oh, wow.
Did I really just forget that melody?
When I popped off, then your girl gave me just a little bit of la cha. Baby so cold, he from the north, he from the Canada. Bankroll so low, I got nothing else that I can withdraw. Ran up the dough.
Hannah's mom, and I have my three beautiful children, Caitlin, Hannah, and Tyler, home for quarantine. It is really a blessing.
Hi, my name is Hannah Giannini, and I'm the middle child of this family, and I just really do not know what to feel about quarantine. Like, I think it's gonna be good because I can, like, work out every day and just, like, finally have a break from junior year.
Hi, I'm Caitlin. I'm the oldest child. I'm 19. As you can tell, everyone is super excited to have me back at home.
Hi, I'm Brad Giannini. I'm the dad in the family here. I'm the boss. I run the show. Everybody listens to me and does whatever I say all the time, right? No, not really. Never, actually.
Hi, I'm Tyler Giannini. I'm the youngest of everyone, and I'm excited to be able to sleep more during quarantine.
Oh, no.
What are you doing right now?
Just texting
a friend. I'm waiting.
It's pretty rude. You should pay attention to us a little bit.
Excuse me. We're ready for your interview.
Oh, okay, just give me a second. You finish this up.
No, like, this is, we told you in advance, like, your interview is right now.
Okay, well, all right, just give me, just give me a sec.
Yeah, just this first little bit of time that she's been home, just been kind of rough, but it'll get better.
She's had a few mean days. It's definitely been weird, like, going from being at college and, like, just having complete freedom. And, like, I feel like they're getting it. Like, at first they were, like, so happy to have me back, and now I feel like they're getting annoyed with me for, like, literally no reason. We had, like, a little dance party the other day, which was super fun, and, like, we've all been watching Ozark together as a family, so I guess it's been fine, but, like, it's definitely just an adjustment.
So there's this new app that I've been, like, really obsessed with.
No, it's not really new. It's actually been out for a really long time, but it's just, like, getting the hype. Like, I've had it for a long time, and, like, obviously so have they, because, like, obviously. But basically, it's the only thing keeping us alive, and all I do every day is, like, do a TikTok dance with Hannah, or, like, Tyler and I will film one with, like, doing cool transitions. Like, it just, like, kickstarts my day and, like...
Yeah, like, you really, it's an adrenaline rush.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's currently week two in the G&E household of quarantine. And I just really don't know how to feel about it. I'm starting to get a little bit, like, worked up and people are getting on my nerves.
Are you kidding me right now? You do not
literally
respect
what?
Me at all. Like, get off your phone.
How is this about respect?
You are on your phone. Give me
stop!
Give me that.
Yeah, stop.
Are don't you kidding me right now? Like, this is just not okay. Are you, like, you need to respect
I
me.
Don't understand. What is the problem? I was sitting here on my
I
phone
was having a
talking
phone
to my friends, and you come in and expect me to give your full undivided attention when I'm literally just sitting here, like, literally talking to my friends, and you start yelling at me for not paying attention.
I was having a full-on conversation.
Yeah, and did you notice how I wasn't participating in it?
You have no idea, like, how furious I am right now. I never get the respect from her that I deserve. Like, it's honestly putting me to a tipping point.
Okay, honestly, I literally, like, don't understand what she's saying or, like, where she's coming from. Like, I'm sorry. Like, I don't want to be rude. Like, I want to be empathetic.
Tyler, can you, like, please come help with the dishes, Hannah? I've
been
doing
working for 20 minutes.
And you're literally just sitting there on your phone.
I'm literally just about to go.
Okay, well, the other 20 minutes weren't about
for, like, 15 minutes.
You guys are so annoying.
You aren't doing
Tyler,
our work!
What? We're literally...
Oh my god, he's
so annoying.
They're so annoying. I did the dishes literally so much more than them. I can't believe they have the audacity to even say that I don't do the dishes.
These kids only have two jobs in this dang house and they get paid $1 million to do them. Take out the garbage and do the dang kitchen.
I just really need my family to, like, stop interrupting me. Are you serious? Did you just see that?
Hey, Tyler, what's up? I'm just doing my lovely daily check-in that I know you look forward to every single day. What's on your list today? You don't know. Well, we need to stop saying I don't know and go to your Moodle and check it out. Okay, well, let's do our check-in, Tyler. I know you're excited about this. So, Brad, pop up in the Moodles and let's go
okay.
through step by step and see what's going on
so
in the classes.
How did it go last week, Tyler? Did you get everything done?
Yeah.
You're all done?
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
Okay, well, I think we need to actually
what?
Go through, like, each class.
Why?
Like,
but he just said he's done.
Math.
I just asked him and he said he's done.
Do you believe that?
Yeah, well, yeah. Are you done?
Yeah.
Okay, he's done.
Yeah, that's not what Eric says. Well, I'm done too. I'm not doing check-ins anymore.
All right.
I am so upset. Now I have to take over managing Tyler. Brad, this is total BS that Brad is not doing it. I work. I don't want to manage Tyler.
I don't know what Erica's problem is. I'm doing the best I can in these circumstances. It's not that big a deal. Tyler's doing fine.
I hate check-ins, but since they're just fighting with each other, it's not that bad.
So it's week 3. I'm growing
crazy. The kids are driving me crazy. The wife's driving me crazy. I don't get to see Tabari, my massage guy.
Okay, so it's week three. I literally have no energy left to put any effort into any aspects of my life.
I'm kind of unwinding. I'm not working out. Like, this is sad.
So I know this quarantine's been like really bad and all, but also like I feel like there's an like silver lining to it. Like I feel like as a family we've all just gotten a lot closer, and like I feel like we've been able to spend more time with each other, and I don't know. I just wanted to say I really love all of you guys.
I mean, obviously like all families fight, all families bicker, but like I feel like at the end of the day like we all love each other and
yeah
we bonded, and I think I'll always remember this time.
So I know what you're all wondering, and I get this question a lot. So who won the Best Picture Award? Well, Best Picture gets awarded to the film with the best editing, storytelling, and cinematography all in one. And the runner-up to the award will get $100, and the winners of the award will get $200. So without further ado, here they are.
Well, now it's your choice to participate in this festival. We got to see who the judges awarded prizes to, but now it's your turn. I invite you to go to www.padretv.org and click on the Audience Choice Award button and vote for the Audience Choice Award. Your votes will award our final recipient $100. The results of this poll will be posted on padretv.org and CHS Padre TV on Instagram on Friday. So vote for your favorite.
That's the end of our show.
We hope you enjoyed watching.
We laughed, we cried, we certainly tried. Thank you all for watching Carmel High's 2020 Film Festival.
Stay safe out there.
Congratulations to our 2020 seniors.
Be sure to go to PadreTV.org and vote for your favorite.